back in 1948, when Alan Funt came up with the idea of a TV show with people falling for stunts while secretly being recorded on camera, it must have taken a lot of effort to hide those big cameras of the day. Nowadays, cameras are everywhere, and it takes us a lot of effort to hide from their view. Smile. You're on candid camera. A smile, according to the all-knowing and happy folks at Wikipedia, is a facial expression formed primarily by flexing the muscles at the sides of the mouth. It is the opposite of a frown, as you know. But the observer of someone smiling doesn't always know what's behind that show of teeth. In some cultures, smiling too much will lead people to think you're up to no good or have a few screws loose. But generally, in our society, smiling is a good thing. Expressing friendliness or happiness. Toothpaste manufacturers depend on us worrying about our smiles. Art lovers obsess over Mona Lisa's mysterious smile. Barry Manilow crooned, "He couldn't smile without you." While Nat King Cole advised us to smile even if our hearts are breaking. Dick Van Dyke will forever be associated with the song, "Put on a Happy Face." And who could forget Bobby McFerrin's catchy 1988 tune, "Don't Worry, Be Happy." Difficult not to smile when even just thinking of that song. While the world was dealing with a pandemic in 2020, researchers at the University of South Australia found that the act of smiling can trick your mind into being more positive. I have to tell you, the research sounds like it was based on a weird experiment that involved holding a pen or pencil in one's mouth, and some scientists are not so sure the evidence is conclusive. But it sounds good, doesn't it? Smiling can trick your brain into being happy. But have you ever had someone ask you, "What are you smiling about?" As if there was something wrong with smiling. What do you know that I don't? In the letter we call 1 Peter, the apostle writes that followers of Christ have a hope deep in them that others don't understand automatically. The intended readers of this letter were living in dangerous times, being persecuted by Romans and Jews alike for their belief in Christ. Peter advises Christians not to live in fear of those persecutions. Remember, he said, if you are punished for doing good works, you will be blessed by God. Meanwhile, in the end, your persecutors won't do so well. So smile and let others ask why. Today, our sermon is appropriately titled, "What Are You Smiling About?" We hope you'll have a smile on your face by the end of this service. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Greetings, and welcome to the online worship service of Robinson Memorial Presbyterian Church in Gastonia, North Carolina, for Sunday, May 14th, 2023. More than 50 countries around the world set aside a day for good old mom, although not all on the same day. Thailand, for instance, celebrates Mother's Day in August to coincide with the birthday of the current queen. To all the mothers out there, thank you, and we wish you a very happy day. Wednesdays are happy days here at Robinson Memorial. Why? Because that's the day we gather at 2 p.m. in Fellowship Hall for Bible study, and recently for Krispy Kreme donuts provided by Mac. You can join us this coming Wednesday as we continue studying various women of the Bible. Can't promise you donuts, but can guarantee you'll learn something new. Here's something to chew on in the meantime: our responsive call to worship. You'll find the words on your screen. Come and hear, all you who fear God, and I will tell you what the Lord has done for me. Truly, God has listened and given heed to the words of my prayer. You are blessed, O God, because you have not rejected my prayer or removed your steadfast love from me. I will come into your house and pay you my vows, those that my lips uttered and my mouth promised when I was in trouble. Let us worship God. Come, thou almighty King, is the title of today's opening hymn. Please join in singing as Ashley provides the accompaniment. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. But we do know this: when Christ is revealed, we will be like Him. For we will see Him as He is. And all who have this hope in Christ purify themselves, just as He is pure. With this in mind, let us confess our sins before God. Precious God, we cover our ears so we cannot hear the cries of those in need or you urging us to respond. We rush to defend every issue that matters to us, but quickly disperse when you would call us to be your holy people. We shout as loud as we can to cheer on our sports teams, but can manage only whispers when it comes to sharing the good news. Forgive us, and do not hold our sins against us. We would feed on the spiritual food which flows from your heart, so that we might be strong enough to follow Jesus as he leads us in the way, the truth, and the life. And all God's people said, Amen. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. This proves God's love for us. While we were sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely then, now that we have been justified by his blood, will we be saved through him from the wrath of God. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Our first reading for today comes to us from the book of Acts, chapter 17, verses 22 through 31. Listen for the word of our Lord. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, To an unknown God. So, you are ignorant of the very thing you worship. And this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. Our hymn of preparation comes from the 16th century theologian Martin Luther. A mighty fortress is our God. Our second reading from the New Testament comes to us from 1 Peter, chapter 3, verses 13 through 22. Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to anyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have.
but do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. For it is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. After being made alive, he went and made proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago when God waited patiently in the days of Noah while the ark was being built. In it, only a few people, 8 in all, were saved through water. And this water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a clear conscience toward God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand, with angels, authorities, and powers in submission to him. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
First on Sesame Street and then on The Muppet Show, Kermit the Frog debuted a song that would forever be associated with the character. Sure, Frank Sinatra, Ray Charles, Tony Bennett, Lena Horne, and many more all recorded cover versions, but no one could topple Kermit from his toadstool throne. The song, written by Joe Raposo and released in 1970, is "It Ain't Easy Being Green." Being green meant blending in with all the leaves and other foliage so no one noticed him. Why couldn't he have been some other color, like red or gold? By the end of the song, Kermit has a change of heart. After all, green is the color of spring, and it's a cool color. Friendly even. So maybe being green is pretty great after all. It's what I want to be, he declares. From the 1st century AD through the early 4th century, it was not easy being a Christian. The followers of the way were still very much a small minority in the Roman-dominated world centered on the Mediterranean Sea. Pagan worship, and particularly the worship of the current emperor as a god, was the rule, if not the law. Now, these Christians could have made their lives easier by simply going along to get along, pretending to conform to the standards of the world in exchange for personal safety. But they really couldn't do that and still be faithful to the God they confessed as their ruler through Jesus Christ. It's not easy being Christian. At various times, official persecutions were authorized by the Roman government, while some were at the local level. We tend to think about the Emperor Nero the most, but other emperors and provincial officials piled on. They weren't like us. They put together rich and poor, slaves and masters, educated and uneducated. They put them all together, and they are unnaturally coexisting and worshiping together. It's just not right. We need to stamp this movement out. No one has an accurate count of how many of the early Christians became martyrs, giving up their lives to be witnesses to the gospel. Death was the ultimate penalty for defying Rome's demand for conformity. But I'm certain the persecutions came both publicly and in more subtle forms. Knowing all this makes us question the opening line of today's reading from 1 Peter. Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? Who is going to harm us? Peter, are you being real here? We are surrounded by people who want to harm us. Can't you see what's going on? You have to admit, Peter's question seems wildly out of touch. Don't you see what we are suffering? But the reality was that Peter knew all too well about the persecutions. He faced them as well and would be executed for his belief. What set Peter apart and what he advised other Christians to do was to not let fear control their lives. But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened. Peter is, in this passage, is echoing the declaration of Isaiah, do not fear what they fear, and do not dread it. The Lord Almighty is the one you are to regard as holy. He is the one you are to fear. Despite his initial question about who in the world would want to harm you, Peter here acknowledges the dangers are real. But don't be afraid of those dangers. Fear God, not their threats. Now, before getting into what I consider the heart of today's sermon, I want to acknowledge part of our reading which is rather confusing, at least to me. Peter wrote that after Jesus died and was made alive in the Spirit, he appeared before the spirits of those who died long ago, back in the days of Noah. Peter reminds us that just 8 people out of the entire population of the world survived the flood. Peter says those 8 were saved by the water, the same water that killed untold numbers. Now, thinking about Noah and the flood, it seems to me that it was the ark, not the water, that saved his family. Doesn't that make more sense? But remember why God flooded the world. Because the people were irredeemably corrupted, with the exception of Noah and his kin. How long would they have remained righteous in a world overflowing with unrighteousness? The water actually ensured Noah's survival. They were saved through the water. Similar, I guess you could say, to how we are saved through the water of baptism. Water not meant to clean dirt from our bodies, but to provide us with the pledge of a clear conscience toward God. You know, water can be frightening, but like Noah, we don't need to be afraid of what scares those who would persecute us for following Christ. Who can really harm you for doing good? And let's be honest, when you are not frightened by threats of harm or death, those making the threats become angry and confused. Why are you not giving in to me, shaking in fear? What are you smiling about? Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. Here's what I would think is the key takeaway today from Peter. When someone inevitably asks you why you have hope or can smile in the face of danger, despite the threats and intimidation, prepare yourself to give an answer, saying, "I just am," or "I guess I grew up that way," isn't enough. Why? Because then you are saying that you are your own source of hope. Some may even declare their sense of hope comes from the Smith & Wesson. They carry it all times. This is the way of the world, I guess, after all. What was that line from the movie Untouchables? If they bring a knife, you bring a gun. It's not just the Chicago way. Seems like that's the way everywhere. The way of the world means returning threat with threat. Violence for violence. An eye for an eye. A tooth for a tooth. But don't you remember? That's what Jesus preached against. Jesus was the model Peter entreats us to follow. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. Christians are told to pick up their crosses and follow him, knowing full well that there are people in this world who will despise them, hurt them, insult them in front of others. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give you a reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. Gentleness and respect. Today's political discourse seems to have all the gentleness and respect of pro wrestlers arguing in front of a TV camera. Followers of Christ must be better than those wrestlers or politicians. For it is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil, Peter says. Do we believe that? Do we truly believe that? If so, do we always demonstrate it for the world to see? Or are we fearful of what the world will think of us? You know, during last week's Bible study, we discussed a mighty warrior who sacrificed the life of his only daughter rather than lose face by going back on a vow. If I don't shout back at the person shouting at me, I'll be seen as weak. But that's the world talking, not the hope that comes from God. Gentleness, respect. That's the way of Christ. And when someone asks you why you react that way, Peter instructs us to be ready to explain the hope that is anchored in the promises of God shown in the resurrection of the one who died for our sins. When you have that hope, and can say why you have that hope, then you can be at peace despite what evils swirl around you. And you can smile. So, what are you smiling about? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, let us turn our hearts and minds to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, you neither need our praise nor want our burnt offerings. You have created the universe and all that therein dwells. All that we have or will become is an outpouring of your gracious care. You are God, with compassion and redemption flowing from the core of your being. Apart from your mercy, we wander aimlessly through life. In you we live, move, and have our being. And with that assurance, we dare to give you all praise. We look to your Spirit to fill us with counsel and guidance. As the eight were saved through water in the covenant made with Noah, cleanse our conscience through the sacrifice of Jesus made once and for all. Fill us with zeal for the fulfillment of your commandments. Give us endurance and patience when the waters are troubled. May we tread bravely the way of the cross. Today, gracious Lord, we call on you in prayer to be with Robin as she recovers from her procedure. We are so thankful for the improvement in Lee. Continue to be with him and Susie during this time. Our sympathies and our prayers goes to the Saunders-Sanders family. And we still pray for Moselle and her family. Please be with Rick and Nancy, with Mac and Darlene, with Pat Bunton, and with Vicky and Judy, for Lorraine Miller and Jerry, for Sandra, Adrian, Doug, Ashley, and Debbie Holt. We pray for Darla and Kim, for Alan and for Marilyn. Continue to be with Ted Abbott and with Mitchell and Bill, with Beth. Our prayers continue for Martin, Becky, and David, for Brantley and Tiffany, Michaela, Greg Fail, and Johnny Frazier. We pray for Kay and Lorraine, for Bruce and Shirley, for Linda, for Claudette, for Joyce Bell and for TC, for Lauren and Ashley, for Dan Burke and Ray Palmer and Debbie Palmer. Our prayers continue for Amber and for Sherry, for Terry and Morgan, for Barbara Moses, Henry, and Barbara Plyler. Continue to be with Gary, with Lynn Polk and Ronnie Scoggins, with Rachel and Caleb, and Rick Gordon. Great and loving God, your will for us in Jesus is the peace which the world cannot give. Your abiding gift is the advocate he promised. Calm all troubled hearts. Dispel every fear. Keep us steadfast in love and faithful to your word, that we may always be your dwelling place. Grant this through Jesus Christ, the firstborn from the dead,
who lives with you now and always in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever, and who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now, brothers and sisters in Christ, let us proclaim to the world what it is we believe, using the words of the Apostles' Creed, which you'll find on your screen.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As we wrap up today's worship service, our hymn provides the reminder to take time to be holy. Please sing along. We hope that you take time to be holy today and every day. Thank you for joining us today for Robinson Memorial's online worship service. As always, we invite you to give this service a like or a thumbs up, leave a comment, and share this video with others. Hopefully, it will put a smile on someone's face. Also, in just a few moments on your screen, you'll find the mailing address, website address, and a QR code. Use that information to send us your gifts, tithes, and offerings to support this ministry and mission. Big or small, it really helps. We'd love to see your smiles in person during our 11 a.m. worship services, but if not, we'll be right here online next Sunday as of noon. All of you have unity of spirit, sympathy, love for one another, a tender heart and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or abuse for abuse, but on the contrary, repay with a blessing. It is for this that you were called, that you might inherit a blessing. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May He make His face to shine upon you and give you His peace now and forevermore. Amen.